Audible Inc. presents The Millionaire Dropout. Fire your boss, do what you love, reclaim your life. Written by Vince Stanzione. Narrated by Philip Rose. Preface. This book isn't about me, it's about you. If you're listening to the free sample, thinking, why should I buy this audiobook? Then let me tell you. I can help you have an amazing life. I haven't written this book to impress you, but to impress upon you what a non-academic, near-bankrupt, occasionally homeless social dropout can achieve in a relatively short period of time. I haven't written this book to make money. I'm already a multimillionaire and have been for many years. This is a school of hard knocks how-to manual, and there is no exam or fancy degree at the end. But if you follow my advice and take action, you can live a lifestyle others only dream about. You can join the new rich, and I don't mean only rich in money. I mean rich in time and fulfillment. But let's go back a few years. I didn't come from a privileged or well-educated background. My father came to the United Kingdom from a small, poor town in South Italy. He was escaping the mafia and had nothing but a battered case and a few shillings. He couldn't speak a word of English. By working as a hairdresser by day and a waiter by night, I know, all Italians are hairdressers and waiters, he made enough to start his own hairdressing salon and built up a successful chain. He then retired and dropped dead a few years later at the relatively young age of 55. I had no interest in joining the family business, but I did share the family ethos of hard work. At the age of 12, I was doing payroll for the hair salons, washing hair and cleaning. However, I knew I wanted a business of my own. I set up my first mail order business at that age, selling computer games stored on tapes. Remember the Commodore 64 and ZX Spectrum? I was the fairly quiet kid who never fit in. We moved around a lot, so I was always the new kid at school. I was badly bullied for years and teased for being overweight and having the wrong accent. I had about every illness you could think of, including serious asthma, eczema so bad that I struggled to hold a pen, and sight problems that meant I couldn't see the board at school. The only thing I liked about school was selling stuff to other kids, and a few teachers too. At 16, I landed my first job, as a junior in a foreign exchange dealing room. This paid £100, $150 a week, and was an awful job. I was treated like dirt by the dealers, many of whom took drugs and smoked 60 cigarettes a day. But because I didn't want to become a hairdresser, I stuck it out. I learned how to trade financial markets and read everything I could at the local library. I ate the dealer's leftovers in the staff canteen and owned one cheap Marks & Spencer grey polyester suit that stank of smoke. Within 6 months, I was promoted. And within 2 years, I was dealing multi-million dollar positions. I then moved into equities and traded for others and myself. Life was good. I was living the Thatcher dream, or so I thought. Then the 1987 crash wiped me out, and I lost everything. In fact, more than everything. I was ready to be declared bankrupt by my ex-employer who wanted to claw back commission. Luckily, the judge felt sorry for me and threw the case out on the grounds that I had no money to pay. I then worked various commission-only jobs to get a bit of income. I started my own business selling car phones and then mobile phones. Working from a studio apartment, I built that business up from one newspaper ad, merged it with another dealership, and sold my share for a substantial sum a few years later. The truth is, it was worth a lot more than I sold it for. But considering I was only 21 and had nearly been declared bankrupt not so long ago, it felt like an amazing sum of money. I bought my first Rolex watch, which I still own today. Not to show off, but because I knew if I was ever hard up and needed to start again, I could pawn it. Fortunately, I never had to. So, what can you learn from a millionaire dropout? I don't claim to have all the answers. I don't claim that every business or every investment I've made has been successful. However, I do know that if I share my secrets, you will be successful and avoid many of my mistakes. Along my journey from selling computer games on tape, to washing hair, to dealing currencies, to standing in bankruptcy court, to sleeping in a Ford van, to being forced to use a credit card to pay the staff, to escaping from the Russian mafia, trust me, you can't make this up, to floating a business on the London Stock Exchange, to making millions in sales, I have picked up a few tips and secrets. If I can pass on just a few of those to you, I am certain you'll cover the cost of this book many times over. Do you want to come on a journey with me? I sincerely hope so. Vince Stanzione, The Millionaire Dropout. Introduction. You only live once, at least on this planet. So, let me ask you this. Are you making the best of your life, earning plenty of money, and feeling relaxed, happy, and content? Or are you trudging through each day, waiting for life to get better? If you can truly say you're happy with the quality of your life, the amount of money you earn, and your relationships, then listen no further. I congratulate you and would love to learn your secrets. If, however, you're one of the millions who hate getting up in the morning and earning a meager wage at a job you loathe, only to find your paycheck has run out 25 days before payday, keep listening. This book has been written for all those who want to boost their income, reduce their outgoings, and increase their standard of living. Whether you're young, old, previously successful, or have never had any success, I will show you how to create an amazing life that you will love living. The book is divided into three sections. Part 1. Taking control of your life. First, we will focus on you, your goals, fears, past, state of mind, and how to take control of all these things to start living every day to its full potential. I will teach you how to reprogram your mind for success and transform your mood and appearance through diet and exercise. You will finish this section charged up and ready to learn the secrets of making money. Part 2. Making money. I will reveal my money-making secrets and show how you can copy tried and tested formulas to make as much money as you want and deserve. I'll also explain how to get a pay raise and start earning your true worth. Part 3. Saving money. Smart people are good at both making money and saving money. No matter how wealthy you are, it always pays to buy everything at the lowest possible price. And I'll show you how. Whether you're buying a car, toaster, designer dress, or the latest gadget, I will reveal how to get the best deal. There is a better life for you. I don't know what your current position is, but I can guess you want more than you currently have. Perhaps you have money worries or debts and feel that you need or deserve a higher income. Or maybe you have a string of failed relationships and feel uncertain about the future. Somehow, life is passing you by, and although you know you should be doing better, you're stuck in a rut and not living, but scarcely existing. The good news is, there is a better life. You can increase your income, pay off debts, and, most importantly, increase your quality of life and gain self-confidence and respect. You genuinely can have everything in the world that you really want. And I will show you how. Always remember, it could be worse. I can tell you truthfully that however bad your situation is, Whether you're in debt, have personal difficulties, low self-esteem, or are addicted to drugs or alcohol, I can guarantee you're not alone, and there is a way out. I want you to remember this. You may be crying and upset because you haven't any shoes, but spare a thought for the person next to you. He hasn't any feet. And that's your first lesson. It may look bad, but believe me, it could be worse. Only you can change your life for the better. You are in charge of your life. Everything that's happened to you in the past, your successes, failures, and problems, were brought about by your actions, or lack of them, in one way or another. I know the truth hurts, but this book is about getting results, and not just telling you what you want to hear. It's easy for us to blame other people for our failures, problems, and shortcomings. How many times do you hear people say, "It's my boss's fault, my wife's fault. If only I was older or younger. I blame the government." The truth is that you are in charge of your life. You're the driver of the train, and you can either choose to drive around the world on a rich, fulfilling, and rewarding journey, or leave the train standing in the station, with the wheels rusting away and the engine seizing up. I believe we live in amazing times, with an abundance of opportunities. You may not agree, and I can understand why. Every day the media is full of doom and gloom about the bad economy and what terrible things are happening in the world. The truth is, with advances in technology, it's never been easier to achieve your financial and lifestyle goals. And it gets easier every day. But back to the train. You choose. 95% of the population are at the station. Are you in that 95%? Are you standing still, watching life pass you by? If you believe in safety in numbers, then stay exactly where you are. Go with the flow and stick with the masses. If, however, you want to join the 5% of people who are driving their trains to amazing places, keep on listening. This book will help you get the train started. And once you get going, you'll be amazed that you were ever standing still. I'm not saying you'll go flying out of the station at 100 miles per hour, but even if you start to pull away at 1 mile per hour, that's faster than the 95% who are standing still, right? Do you really want life to change? You can do anything you set your mind to. Earn lots of money, give up smoking, drugs, or alcohol, get into shape. But only if you really want your life to change. This book can help make your life better, but only if you work with the advice given in these words and take action. I can reveal my wealth secrets to you, but ultimately only you can put those secrets into action and make things happen in your life. I guarantee that if you want a better life badly enough, this book will help you achieve it. Some years ago, a baseball manager, Tommy Lasorda, said, "There are those who watch things happen, those who wonder what happened, and those who make things happen." Which person are you? A watcher or a player? You need to become a player to win in life. Being a spectator and watching the world go by just isn't any fun. Others may be content to exist and get by being a government chart statistic, but I know that you're not satisfied with being a number. You want to do better than that. I'm very unlucky. I come from a background that believes you make your own luck. If you work 14 hours a day, it's amazing how lucky you will become. Luck is determined by our own efforts, the blood, sweat, and tears we put into life. I'm sorry, but I don't believe luck has anything to do with whether Jupiter is in Mars, or this year is the Chinese animal year I was born under, or my horoscope in the Daily Downmarket newspaper says today will be good for finances. I have done a fair amount of research into luck over the last few years, and had the pleasure of meeting Professor Richard Wiseman, author of The Luck Factor. He points to four main areas that separate lucky people and unlucky ones. 1. Lucky people are good at creating chance opportunities. 2. They are good at thinking lucky. 3. They are good at feeling lucky. 4. They believe in denying fate. I don't like the term opportunity knocks. I have found in 99% of cases, it doesn't. If you're sitting at home waiting for opportunities to ring the doorbell, I'm sorry to say this is very unlikely. You make your own luck in this world, and mine was created by going out and searching high and low for opportunities. If you start creating opportunities, it's amazing how often you will be in the right place at the right time and how lucky you will become. Part 1. Taking control of your life. Chapter 1. Getting started. Changing your life will take effort, perseverance, and time. Most people spend 20 to 30 years messing up their lives. They overeat, overdrink, don't save for the future, don't learn new skills, let their minds seize up, and then hope life will change without them lifting a finger. The truth is that success and riches come to those who take action and then put in the hours. A steady amount of effort is far better than a short burst and then nothing. It is a fact that the only way to lose weight is by a steady diet and not a get-slim-quick regime. The old Chinese proverb, "A journey of a million miles begins with one step," is very true in these circumstances. Take your time, but take that first step. Making money and increasing the quality of your life is similar to being on a diet. You'll have high points and low points. But the key is to keep going and not give up. Tiny steps lead to massive leaps. Success normally comes not from one big change or action, but from lots of small successes that build into a big success. Remember this as you work through the book. Steps that may seem stupid, pointless, and meaningless on their own will combine to make massive leaps forward in your life. Imagine a brick. A brick on its own is not very exciting, stylish, or useful. But when thousands or millions of bricks are put together, they create amazing buildings. You often hear a famous actor called an overnight success. But the truth is, there is no such thing. I know many stars are deeply offended by this term, since most work for years in the background before their big break. They build up small successes, such as TV commercials, small background parts and theatre roles. And all this hard work eventually leads to a major part. This is a great example of the small successes leading to a big success. Can you go the extra mile? I'm guessing the truthful answer to this question right now is no. However, over time, and with the help of this book, we must change that answer to yes. If you look at life's winners, whether they are great business people, sports people, or show business celebrities, one of their strongest attributes will be their ability to go the extra mile. Imagine you are a salesman. You've been out all day knocking on doors without any success. It's getting late and you're tired. Do you give up and go home, or try those extra few doors? It could be that behind those extra doors is the commission you've been working all day for. Successful inventors are very good at going the extra mile. Many top inventors and scientists kept going, even when everyone told them not to. The end result? An amazing new invention or discovery. Famous explorers are well known for their successes. But what most people don't know is that they have had many failed explorations too. However, I've observed that successful explorers don't let these failures stop them. As soon as one attempt fails, they plan their next attempt. They don't give up, and eventually one of their explorations is a success. Many best-selling items we use every day were called stupid or useless at one time or another. If that inventor had given up because he had been rejected, all his hard work would have been wasted. Do you know that many top-selling bands, like the Beatles and U2, were turned down by several major record labels? The Beatles were told they were losers and would never last. And we all know what happened to them. When you go the extra mile, you will stand out and shine. Today, most people try to get by with the minimum amount of work or effort. That's why when someone goes the extra mile, especially in the service industry, the effort really stands out. I'll talk more about this later. Now, let's get back to you. As you listen to this book, you will be asked to put various plans into action. You will be asked to change the way you act and think. You may meet resistance from people around you as they sense you are trying to change your life. They may accuse you of being stupid or insane and advise you to give up. When things don't seem to be working out, they may say, "I told you it wouldn't work." Like the famous inventors and explorers of history, you must learn to ignore these people. Stick to the plans outlined in this book, and I guarantee you will prove them all wrong. People may put you down today, but when you drive past them in your new shiny Ferrari and they're standing at the bus stop, I guarantee you will be laughing louder. Your present circumstances don't determine where you can go. They merely determine where you start. Nido Cubain. Breaking free from your comfort zone. Right now, you are living in your comfort zone. This is what you are familiar with. And if you're like most people, it involves commuting to a job you'd rather not do, then commuting home, watching TV, sleeping, and starting all over again. On the weekends, you do what you can with your meager pay, including buying a lottery ticket. Most people see this as a normal and acceptable way to live. What a waste of life. Yet millions of people are living or existing like this, as you listen to this book. Here's a quote to think about. I go to work, I earn my bread. I watch TV and go to bed. Sunrise, sunset, year to year. Before I know it, winter's here. Dennis Waitley. This may sound harsh, but if you're truly honest with yourself, you will agree that 95% of the population live like this, possibly including yourself. Go to a train station during rush hour and see people running around like headless chickens. Look at the way they dress, their postures, their facial expressions. You can feel and smell the stress and pollution in the air. Is this the way you want to live? Of course not. So why are you? Because you are stuck in your comfort zone and can't imagine a different life. We stay in our comfort zone because it feels normal to us, and we're scared of failure, embarrassment, and change. The majority of people accept a life that isn't great, and deep down believe that dreams, goals, and desires will only cause pain. They have lost all hopes of being a billionaire. They just want to earn a living and get by. Benjamin Franklin once said, "Most men die at 25. We just don't bury them until they are 70. Harsh, but true. This is life in the comfort zone. Most of us have been brainwashed by parents, friends, teachers, the media, and our bosses to believe it's okay not to strive or achieve, and that it's better to stay exactly where we are. If you're brave enough to break free of your comfort zone, I guarantee this book will improve your life. you can and will do better than you are doing today. I want you to be unhappy with your comfort zone. It's time for you to change and act. I want you to dream and reach for the stars. Today is the first day of your new life. When you reach for the stars, you may not quite get one, but you won't come up with a handful of mud either. Leo Burnett. Why I want you to succeed. Let me share a secret of successful people. We offer products and services that actually work and improve people's lives. If this book makes you a success, then you'll tell other people, and my sales will increase. If this book doesn't work for you, then you'll be unlikely to tell anyone about it, and probably won't purchase any more of my books or DVDs. I believe success is always a good thing, and that other people's success will not affect me in any negative way. This book is a win-win partnership. I really do want you to succeed and be happy. As you change your life, there will be times when it feels as though it's you against the rest of the world. Remember that in me and this book, you have a partner. I am on your side. So there's two of us against the rest of the world. And together, I promise we can achieve anything. Before we get started, I want to apologize in advance if I sound arrogant, rude, or harsh in any of the following words. I need to shake you loose of your negative thoughts and fire you into action. And this may require a kick in the rear. I would also like to point out that I am the most equal-minded person you will ever meet. I want everyone to be a success, whether you're a man, woman, black, Asian, green, pink, or whatever. So when I state him, he, or man, and so on, it could equally be her, she, or women, and so on. We're here to learn, not have fun. If I had a dollar for every time I was told, "We're here to learn, not have fun," when I was at school, I would be a billionaire. Did you hear something similar when you were at school? When I became an employee, it was the same again. You're here to work, not mess around. It sends a very clear message, doesn't it? Doing something worthwhile, like learning or earning money, isn't fun. Well, I'm here to rebel. I believe you can learn, work, and have fun. In fact, I believe that if it's fun, it gets done. That's why this book is informative, but fun too. So if you're not smiling right now, listen to the following and see if you can lighten your mood a little. Have you ever said something that doesn't quite come out how you meant it? Here are a few true quotes written on motor vehicle insurance forms or statements made to the police. Coming home, I drove into the wrong house and collided with a tree I don't have. I had been driving my car for 40 years when I fell asleep at the wheel and had an accident. Here's my favourite, apparently given to the police. The guy was all over the road. I had to swerve a number of times before I finally managed to hit him. I hope you're smiling, at least a little. The quicker that the learning and working can be fun mentality sinks in, the quicker you'll finish this book and start creating success in your life. So, let's get started. Chapter 2. Let's talk about you. We're going to talk about the most important person in the world. You. Unless you get in the right frame of mind, it's pointless trying to make or save money. Many of the techniques discussed in parts 2 and 3 will only work once you are feeling strong and have clearly outlined your goals, wants, and needs. Do not skip this section. If you skip this section, you may as well put the book down right now. Yes, you're eager to start, but we need to build strong foundations. Without strong foundations, it doesn't matter how well the building is designed and put together. It will fall down. I have a question for you. How much do you think you're worth? A. $1 million. B. $10 million. C. $100 million. Before you answer this question, let me make you an offer. Let's imagine I'm a body broker. I buy and sell body parts, such as eyes, legs, hearts, and so on. Now, imagine I offered you $10 million for your eyes and another $10 million for your legs. Would you sell me your eyes and legs? The answer is no, of course not. No amount of money could buy these things. So, how much are you worth? The answer is none of the above. You are priceless, a unique person, with a better brain than the most powerful computer in the world. Even with great new technology and modern microprocessors, computers cannot compete with you. Your biggest asset is that you are the original, one and only. Of the 6.9 billion people currently inhabiting the Earth, there never has been, and never will be, another you. You are truly an incredibly sophisticated creation. Let me tell you a few facts about yourself. Your body has the capability to repair itself continually at the rate of 2 billion cells per day. Don't you wish that dent in your car could do that? 98% of the atoms in your body change in less than 1 year. More specifically, you change your skin about every 20 days, your stomach about once a month, all of your brain cells every year, and your skeleton once every 3 months. Just think, by the time you've finished listening to this book, you will be a new person, both in mind and body. So, if you want a new start, well, you already have it. A few other things about yourself. Your brain has limitless capacity to store and process information. You have about 600 muscles. You have about 200 bones. You have about 20 square feet of skin. Your heart beats about 100,000 times per day. Your kidneys will remove 1 million gallons of waste products from your blood by the time you are 70 years of age. The most expensive, rarest, beautiful, and precious asset that you will ever own is not a painting, piece of jewelry, or anything else. It's you. Now, I want to teach you an important lesson in self-confidence. Regardless of your past failures or current difficulties, you can and must believe in yourself. If you don't believe in yourself, you will never be able to convince anyone else to believe in you. I've worked in banking in the past and turned down many business loan applications for the simple reason that the applicant didn't believe in himself or his new business. If you don't believe in yourself, how can you convince a bank or anyone else to back you? Remembering you are valuable and unique is the antidote to criticism and depression. The next time someone puts you down or you feel sorry for yourself, remember how precious you truly are. Write this on a piece of paper in big letters and read it over a few times. The most expensive, rarest, beautiful, and precious asset I will ever own is me. Feeling better? Good. You should. Feeling positive about yourself inspires the confidence you must have to do well in life. The aim of this section is to make you A. start feeling more successful, B. act as if you are more successful. The combination of A plus B equals you will be more successful. Time for some surgery. No, I don't mean cosmetic surgery. I mean surgery from within. Changing the way you look and feel about yourself. Let's start with the way you act and present yourself to others, whether it's in person or on the telephone. Here are the important qualities you need to present yourself well. A smile. A smile can get you a long way. You can even hear a smile on the telephone. If you ask for something with a smile, there's a far better chance you'll get it than if you look glum and grumpy. Smiling is a positive statement about yourself. It gives others confidence and implies success. The great thing about a smile is that it is international. I can't speak Japanese, but if I walked into a room of Japanese-speaking business people, I could smile and they would have positive feelings towards me. One well-known telesales company puts mirrors on its staff's desks, so salespeople can see their facial expressions while they're selling. Apparently, sales are soaring. A warm, rich tone to your voice. To be able to speak in public is a very desirable asset. But like everything worthwhile, it takes practice and courage. The way you speak can either help or hurt you. I'm not saying you should try to speak like the Queen. That would be false, unless you actually are the Queen. Nor should you change your accent. What I do recommend is try to speak clearly, without cutting words short. Speak too quickly and you'll sound nervous. Speak too slowly and you'll sound boring and may annoy people. Practice your speech by recording it on your mobile phone or dictaphone and listen back. If you're not naturally a good speaker, it would be wise to invest in one of the many books or DVDs dedicated to this subject. There are also free clips on YouTube that give tips on public speaking. If speaking is a real stumbling block, consider enrolling in a public speaking class. This is an excellent way to improve both your speech and all-round confidence. We live in a media age, and I guarantee that clear speech is a huge asset. As a highly successful person, the chances are you'll appear on television, radio, or YouTube at some point. In the meantime, you'll speak on the telephone at least a few times a week. And a good, clear voice will be of great benefit. It's very important to be able to use the telephone effectively, whether you're booking a reservation for a hotel or selling something. Never underestimate the importance of your telephone manner. I've sold hundreds of thousands of pounds worth of products over the phone, ranging from computer software to stocks and shares. And the best tip I can give you is to stand up or walk a few paces while you're talking. Trust me, it makes a difference. With Skype and teleconferencing services such as GoToMeeting.com, we are now using the telephone more than ever before. Most of us aren't taught how important telephone skills are, or given the opportunity to learn them. Go the extra mile. Take the time to practice your telephone manner, and instantly you'll be ahead of most people in life. Enthusiasm in what you request. Don't sound unsure or timid, even if you are. Ask for the product or service you require with enthusiasm, and 9 times out of 10, you'll get it. Trust me, enthusiasm works. Good eye contact. People who don't look others in the eye are seen as shifty and dishonest. It's important to maintain good eye contact with others. This is an easy thing to do with practice. If you're holding a web meeting, make sure the camera is at eye level or a bit higher, and look straight into the camera, not at the person on the screen. If you're on a laptop with a built-in camera, prop it on a few books so that the camera is at eye level. A firm handshake. In the age of video conferencing and email, it's easy to forget about a handshake. But it remains as important as ever. When you're introduced to someone for the first time, a firm handshake gives the very best impression. Whether you are male or female, you should not be afraid to shake hands firmly. Sincerity and interest in others. You can't fake friendliness. This is a very important quality, and without question, it helps you get what you want in life. Every day, you will come across people who can make a big difference to your comfort and success. These include hotel desk clerks, airline check-in staff, waiters, office clerks, and salespeople, to name a few. In part 3, you will see how these people can make the difference between flying in the worst seat in economy or the best seat in first class. So take note. Most of us treat the little people with no respect or dignity. Show some interest in the people you interact with, whether they be a shop assistant, taxi driver, or bartender, and you'll reap the rewards. You don't have to be false, but look cheerful and ask a few questions to show your interest in others. These questions needn't be too taxing. Saying, "It looks busy or quiet today," or "You're working late or early today," is a great way to show you care about someone else's life. Why bother? First, it's courteous to your fellow human being. And second, if the clerk can offer an upgrade, better product, or way to save money, who will he think of first? The person who looks friendly and takes an interest, or the person who treats him as though he were invisible? Every time you talk to someone new, either in person or by phone or email, you have the opportunity to sell yourself. You'll never get along with 100% of the population, but you can try and beat the averages. A purposeful posture. Stand tall, no matter what your height, and you will communicate that you deserve and expect respect. I've read that taller people are more successful in life, and this may have some truth. However, I believe a purposeful posture is more important than your height. Walking tall and sitting well communicates confidence and success to others. It also helps you speak more clearly and prevents back pains later on in life. Ensure that your head is held high and your eyes look straight ahead or up. It is impossible to feel good if you are constantly looking down. An upright posture coupled with energetic movements, a bounce in your step, and a good smile instantly give you an air of success. And what do these things cost you? Absolutely nothing. If you feel depressed, put on a smile, change your posture, and I guarantee that you will feel happier. Be proud. Walk like a peacock with its feathers spread out, not hunched over and looking down as though life has defeated you. Let's summarize. If you speak quietly with a slow and boring tone and have a slouching posture, people won't think you are successful. As a result, you probably won't feel successful. So it is important to put the points discussed here into practice as soon as possible. Even if your financial position has not changed, you will start to feel better by putting these simple things into effect. I don't know about you, but I like to deal with colourful people. By this I mean people who are happy, smiling, and enthusiastic, both in their movements and voice tones. If I'm going to take on an employee, this is the type of person I want to hire. I don't want dull, boring, and depressing people who act as though they're made out of wood. As I've already said, standing tall, smiling, and talking well are easy. And with practice, they cost nothing. If you've ever talked to shop assistants and said to yourself, "They're not very helpful," or "They don't look happy," consider that you too, at times, might give off the wrong impression. Smiling is contagious. You smile at people, and in most cases, they smile back. If you look grumpy, chances are you'll see grumpy expressions mirrored around you. Try it out and see what I mean. You may have heard the phrase, "fake it till you make it." I prefer to say, "acting as if." Act as if you already have what you want, and the chances are you'll get it. Life is a self-fulfilling prophecy. If you're confident and take small steps, you'll start getting what you want. It may not happen overnight, but you'll get there. Listening. You have two ears and one mouth, which suggests you should spend twice as long listening than talking. Most people get it the wrong way round and talk far too much. but being a good listener will help you immensely, both in your personal and business life. I've discovered many money-making ideas by listening to people. I regularly listen to talk radio, where people phone in and give their opinions and concerns. By listening, I get a good idea of what people are interested in and concerned about. I then develop products to fill people's needs, based on what I've heard. Most people like to talk about themselves, and a lot of people divulge trade secrets by talking too much. I've watched people mess up sales that were in the bag by over-talking. When I was in telephone selling, I would always get off the phone as soon as possible once the client had said yes. Being able to listen actively is a very valuable and profitable skill. I've met people who claimed to really enjoy my company and conversation, but I had only spoken a few words during our meeting. People really do like to talk about themselves, so let them, and you'll be very well liked. On the point of listening, let people finish before you butt in or try and preempt what they are going to say. First, it's annoying to be interrupted. And second, you can do yourself a lot of damage by wrongly assuming what someone is going to say. Think before you speak. I know from time to time we all say things that we live to regret. But if you remember to think twice and speak once, this will happen less often. The same goes for emails, text messages, and social network chat. It's easy to send a message, but nearly impossible to get it back. Think twice before clicking send, and make sure your message isn't saying anything you might later regret. Dressing for success. I believe you should never judge people by the way they dress. However, most normal companies still believe if you wear a suit and tie, you are successful. But if you wear jeans and sweatsuits, you aren't worth doing business with. You need to dress to suit the occasion and the people you're meeting, taking into account their age and business. If in doubt, go smarter. But mainly, you should dress how you think the other person would expect you to look. The right dress code for men. The classic business uniform for a man is still a good suit with a plain white or pale-coloured shirt and stylish, colourful tie. A good quality pair of clean, comfortable leather shoes finishes this outfit. Avoid striped shirts, shirts with a different coloured collar to the body, and novelty or garish ties. Grooming. You should have clean hair and be well shaved. If you have a beard or moustache, make sure it's clean and tidy. Aftershave is fine, but it should never be overpowering. Good skin. Most men spend little or no time looking after their skin, yet a good complexion is important. There are now many male grooming products, such as cleansers and moisturizers. Start including them in your daily routine. And if you get stuck on what to buy, ask your wife or girlfriend for help. The right dress code for women. Although women have more options and can be a bit more adventurous with colours, I still think a good suit is the best bet. Dress smart, but not overly sexy, as this will intimidate both men and women. Grooming. Hair should be neat and clean, and should not cover the eyes or cause you to keep sweeping it away. Although colouring your hair is acceptable these days, you must ensure the colour is well maintained and professionally done. Makeup. Makeup is an essential part of everyday life for most women. However, I believe more women should take advice, read books, or attend courses on how to apply makeup effectively to suit their face and skin. I also believe that, like clothes, makeup should be varied to suit the occasion. Applying makeup well makes a big difference to the final effect. So, if you're not sure how to do it, take a look on YouTube for makeup tips, Search for Pixie Woo and you'll find an abundance of advice. Perfumes. I don't believe there is a problem with perfume, but it must not be too overpowering. Remember that less is more. Your inner voice. Outward appearance is important, but your inner voice is more so. The silent words we all say to ourselves produce feelings. These can be positive, happy and life-enhancing, or negative, unhappy and detrimental. Others will sense how we're feeling and react to us accordingly. Just as we need to project the right external voice, we also need to have the right internal voice. As you listen to this, do you hear a whiny, sleepy, apologetic voice? Or a rich, strong, energetic voice? Feel excited about what you are learning. You should be excited. Your life is changing for the better. Happy music makes happy people. Music and the sounds that surround us can have a massive effect on our mood. If you don't believe me, try listening to a morbid, slow song, then listen to a fast, upbeat song. It makes a difference, doesn't it? Pay attention to what you're hearing, especially around bedtime, as this really can affect what's going on in your subconscious mind. Chapter 3. What do you want out of life? Unless you know what you want to achieve, you'll never get it. Excuse me for being blunt, but the biggest reason for not living life to its fullest is not because you're unlucky, disadvantaged, bad at math, or whatever. It's because you've never sat down and laid out your goals and ambitions. Imagine going into a travel agent and saying, "Send me somewhere." The agent would say, "Where do you want to visit?" You would say, "A really nice place, you know, a place I can be happy. A place I can have an important job, a beautiful wife, some nice kids. A really great place." Could a travel agent help you? Of course not. People can't help you until you tell them exactly what you want. What do you want? I suppose you want lots of money and a good life. That is not a specific goal. People say this all the time and then spend their money on the lottery. You have to be far more specific than this. Even if you believe in yourself, success is impossible without specific, well-defined goals. I've asked hundreds of people, "What do you want out of life?" And very rarely do I ever get an answer. Even when I do, it's something like, "I want to be happy." Most people just don't know what they want. And that's why they don't get anywhere. Before you listen to this book, I would be amazed if you had already written a goals sheet. I would guess that 99% of the population don't have well-defined or written goals. When I was younger, I didn't have any specific goals. I had ideas and vague generalities, but not any goals. As a result, I didn't get anywhere. Until I developed specific, well-defined goals, I did not succeed. When I wrote down my goals, everything changed for the better. Your roadmap to success. If you wanted to drive from London to Edinburgh, would you get in your car and drive in any direction? Or would you plan out a journey, get a map, and think about where you were going? Most people are on the road to nowhere, unsure about where they're going, and sometimes even traveling.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.